Good morning, and a warm welcome on this cloudy day to everyone here in the sanctuary of the Reformed Church of Bronxville, as well as everyone who is live streaming. My name is Paul Muir, and I will be assisting our senior minister, Dr. Matt Waterstone, today, along with Cameron and Will. Our RCB website states that the Reformed Church of Bronxville is a family of faith, a home for all, at the heart of the community, filled with extraordinary love with Jesus at the center. We do this through gathering in corporate worship, growing in spiritual formation, giving in humble service, and going in Christ-like mission. Today, we gather in worship and to remind us to spread the word of Jesus, his love and caring for all. Let us rejoice in this message. Please join me in the response in bold to our call to worship printed in the bulletin. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
maker of heaven and earth.
Praise the Lord.
The Lord's name be praised.
Please rise as you are able and sing hymn 469, Morning Has Broken. His promises. We thank you that in Jesus' life, death, and resurrection, we see your love, justice, mercy, provision, and victory. You are the God who lifts up those who are weighed down and teaches us to be more loving and caring for all, including those who are less fortunate than ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning again. Welcome on this cloudy day here in Bronxville. Thank you for joining us on National Bowtie Day. Yes, it really exists, although I didn't see a Hallmark card in the local stores recognizing this special day. Of course, for Pastor Matt, every day is Bowtie Day.
Amen.
But for many of us men, wearing a bow tie is not a daily occurrence. And these days, wearing a necktie is not a daily occurrence. Maybe we wear one on formal occasions such as weddings or maybe a visit to the Metropolitan Opera, but wearing a bow tie is certainly another way of showing that we are different. However, if we think about everyone we see, I'm sure we can find some characteristics or attire or views that show we indeed are all different. What does Jesus teach us about our relationship with people we perceive are different from us or who dress differently from us? What would Jesus do? Jesus reminded us of the importance of relationships with people who are different than us, dress differently than us, or have different views. His teachings remind us to serve others who are different than us or less fortunate than we are, and to be humble in how we interact with them. Our time of confession today requires us to put all other thoughts aside and to focus on those times when we should have followed the teachings of Jesus but didn't, and those times when we could have treated others who are different from us in a better way but didn't, or those times when we could have acted in a more humble way with others but didn't. Help us to follow your example of humility and caring, Jesus. O God, we confess there are many occasions when we don't take the time to listen to others, especially when we feel they are different from us. Help us understand the importance of breaking down barriers between ourselves and others and to be more compassionate. Help us to confess our sins today and begin our week feeling centered in God and the teachings of his Son, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. With these thoughts in mind, please join me in reading the prayer of confession printed in the bulletin, which will be followed by a moment of silence for personal confession. Please join. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed, and grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image. Through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. Good news. Loving Father, you receive all who come humbly before you. Yet too often we think more highly of ourselves than we ought to think. We forget your Son's teaching of those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Empower us to serve you joyfully and wholeheartedly, and forgive us when we fall short of your teaching. Grant us the grace to grow in your image and give us the courage to continue our journey as we follow your Son, Jesus Christ. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voices but your own, so that you may hear your word and follow your teachings. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The scripture reading this morning is from Luke 14, verse 1, and then verses 7 to 14. And you can follow along on your pew Bible on page 849. Luke 14 records a miracle performed by Jesus on Sabbath day, followed by his teachings of a parable. And Jesus teaches humility in the parable of the wedding feast and the great supper. Hear the word of the Lord. On one occasion, when Jesus was going to the house of a leader of the Pharisees to eat a meal on the Sabbath, they were watching him closely. When he noticed how the guests chose the place of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place. And then in disgrace, you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers and sisters or your relatives to rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Pray with me, please. God, your word reminds us to be still and know that you are God. So I humbly ask that by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit, you would still our hearts and our minds. We are prone to be a busy folk, so allow us for just a few moments to slow down, to listen, to be present. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be holy and acceptable in your sight. For you are, on this beautiful day and every day, our rock and our redeemer, in whose name we pray. Amen. So I'd like to turn the clock back to the year 2012. You'll need to come with me to the First Reformed Church in South Holland, Illinois. I'm their pastor, and it's the first Sunday of the month, which meant for that congregation exactly what it means for this congregation. On the first Sunday of every month, we celebrate Holy Communion. The First Reformed Church of South Holland has a beautiful sanctuary, much like ours, with a long center aisle and two large, beautiful stained glass windows, one in the balcony and one above the chancel. On this Sunday, the communion table was prepared front and center. We served communion through trays, so lines of elders dressed in formal black would pass the slices of bread and thimbles of grape juice from aisle to aisle. Like here, I began with the great prayer of thanksgiving, which is a beautiful part in our church's liturgy, and I've committed it to memory. as I was going through the liturgy, out of the corner of my eye, right about there, I saw Raymond. I saw Raymond inch his way closer and closer and closer to the front of the chancel. Raymond was a homeless man. He slept and worked at a nearby car wash. He didn't smell the best. He didn't have many teeth. He wore 4 layers of clothing during the hot summer months. Raymond suffered mightily with mental health struggles. And over the years, our church leaned in and tried to get Raymond the help that he needed. Unfortunately, through a series of difficult conversations with his family, those efforts led to dead ends. However, Raymond was always welcome at the church. He always arrived 20 minutes or so before the church started. He would have a few extra cups of coffee and put a few cookies in his pocket. Unfortunately, the reality is that ministering to someone like Raymond is oftentimes very messy and complicated. In fact, one time our security team at church found him in the women's bathroom. Another time he followed an elderly woman very, very closely to her car, making her feel very uncomfortable. Personally, I never felt threatened by Raymond, but then again, I knew the world that we were living in. So on that particular Sunday, Raymond is lurching his way closer and closer and closer to the front of the chancel during communion. As I was reciting and singing and responding, I could feel the congregation's anxiety rise. I saw heads begin to turn, pointing, eyebrows raised. They were all looking at Raymond. What's going on? Was he all right? Should we do something? If so, what? I'd like for you to hold that uncomfortable and awkward image in your mind's eye for a moment, and we'll come back there in a few. But for now, I'd like to focus on Jesus' dinner party, hosted by a Pharisee, a leading Pharisee, we're told. In his book, The Jesus I Never Knew, author Philip Yancey suggests that too many movies have been made about Jesus portraying him to be rather dull, bland, boring. Most of his words are delivered in a kind of monotone voice, and his overall demeanor is stiff, stuffy, and bland. But yet throughout the Gospels, Yancey suggests that Jesus, he must have been a lot cooler, a lot happier, a lot more joyful than that. People really liked hanging around Jesus. He was popular. He was at the center of social circles. Hence why Luke's gospel, more than any other gospel, there are more dinner party scenes involving Jesus. In fact, on the onset of this string of parables, we're told that Jesus is going to the house of one of the leaders of the Pharisees. So we can imagine that this is a who's who event in the ancient world. You wanted to be invited to this dinner party. And who's at the center of it? Jesus. And we're told in Luke 14, verse 1, that they were watching him closely. So clearly, Jesus is at the very center of the party with all eyes on him. Which is perhaps a simple reminder that the Christian life, dear friends, is meant to be a joy-filled life. A joy-filled life. A life of get-togethers. A life of laughter. A life of parties. Can you just imagine for a moment that if Jesus were strolling through Bronxville, I have a strong hunch that he would absolutely love to be invited to all of our dinner parties, all of our cocktail parties, all of our fundraising parties. Far too often, the Christian life has been portrayed to be a long, boring list of rules, of do's and don'ts, of a moralistic ledger of good deeds and bad deeds, and maybe even free from a life of pleasure. Friends, I for one think this is a serious mistake. So one of my minor claims to fame is that as a faithful member of Calvary Reformed Church in Holland, Michigan, it was in this little church on 8th Street, from the creative mind of Janie Tinklenberg, our choir director, came the WWJD bracelet phenomenon. Anyone else familiar with these bracelets? They were something of a Christian fad in the 90s. Are you tracking with me? WWJD bracelets? Okay, maybe it's just a Midwest thing. I don't know. But they were really cool. They were really cool. And I used to wear one all the time. I never took it off until it smelled so bad that Sarah said, "You got to get this thing off." So now it sits on my dresser. WWJD, what would Jesus do? Friends, instead of thinking about that in terms of lines that I shouldn't cross, of right or wrong, perhaps there's a more interesting and fun way to think of that. What would Jesus do? He'd go to the party. What would Jesus do? He'd enjoy the dinner party, the cocktail party. He'd enjoy the glass of wine at the wedding. In fact, Jesus brought really, really good wine to weddings. There's another story in the Bible about Jesus and a wedding and wine. I'll preach that sermon another day. Dear friends, the Christian life is meant to be a joy-filled life. So put on your Bronxville uniform of dress slacks, a blazer, and no tie, and attend the parties. Stay out late, but not past midnight, because as my grandma would say, nothing good happens after midnight. Enjoy the libation. Claim these spaces for Christ. Be an ambassador of the love and grace and mercy of Christ. Let your light shine brightly, dear friends, into every one of these social settings. In fact, as you do, tell your friends how awesome our youth programs are at the church. Brag about all the ways our church is involved in mission. Maybe, just maybe, comment on a sermon you heard. The Christian life is meant to be a joy-filled life. What would Jesus do? He'd have fun and go to the party. But he would attend the party with the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Friends, we can only imagine how awkward the telling of these two parables must have been. Can you just imagine the dinner party for a moment? The rich, influential Pharisee who throws this grand party. Every social climber is in attendance. Everyone is subtly and not so subtly showing off their wealth and status and power. And here comes Jesus with all eyes on him, and he basically insults everyone at the party with the host at the top of the list. Talk about an awkward and embarrassing dinner party. Jesus is not mincing words here. He is making his point very clear to the dinner party guests of his day and the dinner party guests of our day, that his kingdom radically welcomes the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. Now let's be honest for a moment. This is not the easiest thing to hear, and it's not the easiest thing to preach here at the Reformed Church in the village of Bronxville. In a spirit of love and candor, dear friends, me, are certainly a lot more like the wealthy host of the dinner party or the influential guests of the dinner party. So what do Jesus' poignant words mean for us? Well, I think they mean we are called to develop authentic, meaningful relationships with those who are different than we are. Authentic, meaningful relationships with those who are different than we are.
Amen.
People who don't look like me, talk like me, dress like me, vote like me, live near me. Develop authentic, meaningful relationships. So I'm really glad that attendance is pretty good on the last Sunday of August. And so while everyone isn't here, I'm going to let you all in on some pastoral truth. Would you like to know the sharpest criticism that I've received as your minister in the nearly 4 years that I've been here? You want to know what it is? Here it is. In the summer of 2020, in the wake of George Floyd's murder, the sharpest, harshest criticism that I received was that our church did not do enough in response to racial injustices. From their perspective, our efforts, which included a newly formed action committee, several wide church-wide book reads, anti-bias training, and a more locally robust missional program simply weren't enough. In fact, some people left the church over this. Some people reduced or withheld their pledge over this. It was really, really painful. So in the weeks and months that followed this national travesty, and as a result of the action steps that we took as a church, I reached out to friends and colleagues of color to assess my own heart and leadership trajectory of the church. And my feelings were confirmed by these friends. The reality is, dear friends, is that signs and statements and even marches are fine and good. But what is so much more lasting are relationships. Relationships, dear friends, with people who are different than we are. And that is slow, that is messy, and that is priceless, beautiful work. As author and pastor Scott Jose put it, "We know," he writes, "who Jesus' kind of people were. The question to ask of ourselves and of our congregations in a sermon on Luke 14 is whether Jesus' kind of people are our kind of people." So how about it? Will Jesus' people be our kind of people? Are we as individuals and as families making room to develop authentic, meaningful relationships with those who are different than we are? As your minister, I am so proud of the work of Mary McIntosh, our Director of Missional Engagement, and the literally dozens of opportunities each and every month that are listed in your bulletin right now that we all have for a small bit of time to make on-ramps towards conversations and relationships with folks who are different than we are. Friends, we know whose people Jesus are. Will those people be our people? So come back with me to the sanctuary of First Reformed Church in South Holland, Illinois. There's my friend Raymond, awkwardly, uncomfortably walking towards the chancel while the rest of the congregation looks on in worrisome suspense. Honestly, in that moment, I had several thoughts go through my mind, and most of those thoughts did not end positively. But as I finished saying, "This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the cup of blessing shed for you," I walked down the steps, and in so doing, I could sense the anxiety among the elders in the front row who didn't know what to do or think. And I extended my hand to Raymond, and arm in arm, we walked up the steps, and I served him communion first. Dear friends, it was and still the most powerful, beautiful, transformational opportunity of Holy Communion that I've ever had. That is my hope and prayer for here us at the Reformed Church. That in small but substantial ways, we would extend the radical hospitality and love of Christ to places in Bronxville and Mount Vernon and Pelham and Yonkers and New Rochelle and to the ends of the earth. Dear friends, may we go and do likewise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you for the word written, the Bible, lamp unto our feet, light unto our path. But above all, we thank you for the word that became flesh and dwelt among us, your Son, Jesus, in whom we have life and life eternal. It's in his name we pray. Amen. Again, a word of welcome to those who are joining us here at our 10 a.m. worship service. We start 10:30 on September 11th. So next week, 10 a.m. There's a lot happening in the life of the church as the engines of the program year start ramping up. For a moment, I'd like you to turn into your bulletin to the back part, and there you'll see this circle, and that's a QR code. Here we are at the Reformed Church of Bronxville with our very own QR code for registration for church programs. How amazing is this? So for those of you who have yet to register for our fall programs, take out your phone, snap the QR code, and get on board and register for the amazing programs that are happening this fall. One other thing that I'd like to highlight and celebrate is this is the first Sunday in many Sundays that our main pipe organ is back and is functional in part. So we say thanks be to God for that. We also ask for your continued patience with the many renovations happening in the life of the church. As you walk out this morning, you'll notice you can't see the balcony, right? And that's because, yes, if everyone, why don't you turn back and look? Now that's interesting, isn't it? There's a tarp covering our balcony because we have work being done to our beautiful bell tower. And that work is also being done in the balcony. So a lot happening in the life of the church. I also want to thank members of our Building and Grounds Committee. What a heavy lift of work they are doing. And I give God thanks that we are carefully taking care of this beautiful space that God has given to us. As I mentioned in the sermon, there are many opportunities, even in these late summer weeks, to find ways to develop authentic, meaningful relationships with those who are different than us. And so you'll see those noted in our bulletin as well. And before our morning offering is received, would you please take a few moments, a few extended moments, and share a sign of Christ's peace one with another? truly you are the giver of every good and perfect gift, Holy God. And so many of those good things we've already experienced this morning. So we pray that your Holy Spirit would multiply these gifts so that the love and grace of Jesus would fan out from the corner of Midland and Pondfield to the ends of the earth, all for the glory of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
As a reminder, please join us for coffee, bagels, and fruit in the Edwards Room at the close of the service. The Edwards Room is located through the side doors of the sanctuary to your right. Now let us pray. Dear Lord, we pray for those who may be feeling pain physically or mentally. May they recognize your goodness, and may their sorrow turn into joy, their pain into strength, and their mourning into dancing again. We also pray for those caring for these folks with compassionate listening and careful attention. We pray for those who are looking for their next meal and do not know where it may come from. Holy God, take care of your children and use your people to feed their siblings. We pray for the students getting ready to return to school and for the students entering college for the first time. Comfort them when they miss home. Give them courage when they feel weak, and rejoice with them in the things that they find joy in. We also celebrate with you, God, for the good things that have happened this week. And we thank you for good days and gatherings of friends breaking bread together. And we pray that you remind us that we are all different. And while we may act differently or dress differently, even with bow ties, we all want to be loved. Enter our hearts and teach us humility and caring for each other. We pray for our leaders in Washington, in New York State, and here in Bronxville. Give them courage to engage with other leaders who have different views and follow Jesus' teachings of humility and fellowship. We pray for those RCB members and friends on our prayer list today who are sick, including Muriel, David, Nancy, Jem, Jason, Dan, Kevin, Karen, Philip, Berta, Jean, Heather, Lucy, Arlene, Bob, Brad, John, Lamars, Ida, and Gregory. We also pray for the friends and families of the following individuals who have died, including David Johnson, Karen Lichty, Avis Bryan, Kitty Buttigieg, Edward Higgins, Harry Barr, Carl Hay, and Dee Sorensen. Please surround their families with our love and caring. Please pray all this in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray by saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Please rise as you're able and sing hymn 391, Take My Life.
Take my life.
beloved in the Lord, as you leave this place and enter your mission field, do so knowing that God's Spirit is always with us. And that Spirit this week just might be nudging us a little bit out of our comfort zone to develop authentic, meaningful relationships with those who are different with us. And as you go, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us this day and always. Amen.